Presbyterian Church in Norwood is an open and welcoming and multi-ethnic congregation. And we are continuously sharing our gifts and talents in order to glorify God and to make our community and also our world a better place to live. Together we are creating a sacred space this morning where none of our stories are left behind or none of us have care and hope and our hurt and any of us struggle just leave at the door. We bring all of our concerns and care together this morning in the presence of God so that our cares and concerns are met by the love and mercy of God. So friends, let us become more aware of our being together in this place. Let us become a little bit more deliberate about being sensitive about one another's joy, hurt, and challenges so that we can extend our prayer and supporting for one another. Friends, come, let us worship God.
Please join call to worship. Oh, praise the Lord. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever.
Who will tell of the Lord's mighty acts and make his praises heard?
Happy are they who act justly and do right at all times. Let us worship God.
In this moment of proclamation, God, enlighten us with your spirit,
kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and walk in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the workers and pray them they will pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. So, when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more, but each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired the last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he asked one of them, "I'm not being unfair to you, friend. Did you agree to work for the denarius? Take your pay and go. I will give the one who was hired the last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?" "So, the last will be first, and the first will be the last." Words of God.
Thanks be to God. Identify with the owner of the vineyard. Though we might not be as rich and as generous as he, more likely so, maybe a few of us identified with those who stand idle all day long in the marketplace. Maybe initially the majority of us identify ourselves with the day-long, hard-working workers, and their protest makes sense. Why should those who have borne the heat and burden of the long day be paid exactly the same as those who came in the last hours and only worked 1 hour? It is interesting that we should identify ourselves so quickly with those who labor the hardest. A reporter once asked the Pope John 23rd, "How many people work here in the the city of Vatican, to which the old Pope answered, "Oh, my brother, about half, I guess." Well, how many of us actually work in the vineyard of our Lord Jesus Christ? Should we say about half? Or maybe 20%? The action in the parable takes place around a similar time of the year. Maybe in our American times, a little 2 weeks earlier than time in Israel. But in ancient Palestine, as in Israel today, it is about this time that the grape is growing fully mature. Soon the heavy rain will fall with a devastating effect, and the heavy harvest is at stake because they are racing against the time. All workers are welcome, even those who can only work for 1 hour. The pay in the parable we read is 1 denarius. That is something about, in American dollars, 8 cents. 8 cents. That was normal and that day, and but only sufficient. The workers came from the lowest economic class. They were much like, maybe even in our era, our own migrant workers in America. In ancient Palestine, the marketplace was a hiring hall, so the idle workers weren't there to just hang out and gossip. The fact that they remained all day long until the last hour was an indication how desperately they wanted to work. For if they are not hired even one day, they went home to worried wives and hungry children. Clearly, it was in this injustice that so touched the heart of the owner of the vineyard. The injustice of equal pay for unequal work was as nothing compared to the justice of giving to each according to one's own needs. Marxist incidentally only picked up that slogan, "each according to one's own need," when church had dropped it. Marx only became anti-Christian when he perceived that Christian church is sometimes behaved like inhuman. And not that much has changed, has it? The gospel of Jesus Christ is the answer to most of our human problems, and sometimes the church is still a part of the problem. When you stop think of it, the owner of a vineyard was concerned with the two basic human rights at the heart of the charter of every hard-working people: right to work. All of us are entitled to have that right. And the right to a living wage. This is hardly the point of the parable, but in our time, when unemployment is undermining the right to work for everyone, and inflation, especially these days, the high inflation, the right to a living wage, and when both are largely caused by sometimes selfish national interests or military conflicts as we experience these days. Our God is like the owner of the vineyard. God cannot bear to see the unemployed, a capable person who are not able to share their talent and contribute to our society. God sees the worried mother and hungry children. God pities the poor. God is outraged at their plight, particularly in a rich country where poverty can no longer be termed as a private misfortune, but rather as a public crime. Now let us turn to the main point, to the heart of the parable, which is really at the heart of the gospel itself. You remember the day-long hard workers? They all cried out, "It's unfair." But the owner said to one of them, "My friend, I'm not being unfair to you. You agreed on usual wage, and so take your pay." No one was getting less than a subsistence wage, and the workers got what they bargained for. So there is no unfairness there. No, what the workers were grumbling about, and if you remember what the older brother in the story of prodigal son was complaining about, was something that haunts every one of us. It is the fear that somewhere someone might be getting away with something. The grumbling of the workers and the complaint of the older brother reflects the profound truth that when we demand justice for ourselves, 9 out of 10 times, it is envy disguising as justice. Sigmund Freud once made this remark: "The demand of justice are but a modification of our envy." So quite properly the owner said, "Why be so jealous when I'm kind?" But envy is still not what this parable is essentially about. The parable really opposed two deep-seated human existence, two kinds of world, if you will, between which go back and forth like, what do you call that, a shuttlecock on a room. And they are the world of merit on the one side, and the other side is a world of grace. We live in between this world of merit and world of grace. The full day workers lived in a world of merit, and like most believers in a world of merit, they believe in the merit system, and they consider themselves as meritorious, deserving of their reward. But for some people to feel deserving, some other people must feel not deserving. In the parable, they are the other workers. So in the eyes of the day-long workers, hard-working people, the owner's graciousness becomes injustice. Instead of seeing themselves as self-centered, they see the landowner as unfair. And the tragedy is that these people, they estrange themselves from the source of God's graciousness. The point of the parable is not that while some get by on merit, others need grace. The parable explains why in our world some people never receive. By contrast, in the world of grace, we pray for mercy and forgiveness and the grace of God. We don't pray all the time for justice, make this world fair, make my work fair, and we fight against the system. We know we don't earn and deserve what God has given us, our family, the ability that we move around, have fun in our lives and have relationship, have this sacred time to worship together and affirming our common identity as God's children. We don't worry about someone getting away with something secretly, for we ourselves know that we are getting away with something for nothing. And how joyful life becomes when you understand that in this world of grace, salvation is a gift, not a reward for work done. When I was a seminarian and worked in Brooklyn for about 3 years, I tried one day in my youthful eagerness, because I was hot, like I didn't know how to handle this hot potato of the salvation, the joy of salvation. So I wanted to talk to a bookie out of his chosen vocation. He listened, I must say, very patiently. And then he said, "Son, one of these days you are going to be a preacher, aren't you?" I said, "Yes." "Why?" "You believe in grace, then, don't you?" I said, "Yes." "Why?" And he said, "I tell you why, son. You believe in grace, and I believe in gambling. And that means both of us believe that life is good when it is something for nothing." I don't know much about gambling. I think many gamblers may really want to lose. But the bookie was right about grace. It makes winners out of human beings, something for nothing. So you can live briefly. And while in the world of merit, we estrange ourselves from God, in the world of grace, we are at home with God. There is the message this morning. We come to PCIN to find that our home is with God. Here on earth, we have no abiding place. As Scripture reminds us, we are like the migrant workers in some sense. Only instead of being born in the barns, we are born in the Spirit and nurtured in God's grace, and always, always at home with God. Psalmist pray, "Keep me, O God, for in thee have I found refuge. In thy presence is the fullness of joy. In thy right hand, pleasures forevermore." Psalm 16. At home with God. At home with one another. We are, of course, at home with all the world, even strangers, which belongs to God. So let us also pray to God that these walls, the walls of our church, will not get so thick to cut out the sound and health and cries of our neighbors and our friends and those who live in our society around our church. More than ever, we must help the neglected kid in our community. We got to feed the hungry people. We got to close naked and always with an eye on the goal, which is not just to alleviate the pain of the poverty, but rather to eliminate its deep-seated causes. So on this Sunday, there is much to do, and we shall do it together. And we will be paid with the wages of grace. For it is by His grace that you are saved, through trusting Him. It is not your own doing. It is God's gift, not a reward for work done. There is nothing for anyone to boast of, For we are God's handiwork, created in Jesus Christ our Lord, to devote ourselves to the good deed for which God has designed for us. In the world of grace, God waits to embrace every one of us in God's everlasting loving arms with God's amazing love and grace. Let all God's people say, Amen. Amen. As you reflect on the messages, let us join singing hymn number together, 203. Yesu, Yesu, fill us with your love. Here this morning, she's away for family, I think, event. She will remind us that we will have a session meeting next week, September 7th, on Wednesday evening, not on Monday evening, Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock via Zoom. So all the session members, please make this check mark. Yes, Kathy. And since Rhonda is here, maybe Rhonda, you can share about something about community beauty school.
Well, as director of the community music school, I do encourage and invite all of you to enter into being involved with the program. We're going to start back probably the third Tuesday of September, and the program will be greatly enhanced by those of you who could come and be present. If you can play an instrument, wonderful. If you can't, it really doesn't matter. What we need is presence of people to enjoy the children. I think that's a good way of putting it. It's really too much for these two hands that I have. So your presence of We'll be sharing more information electronically as time goes on, but please know the need and the welcome I have for all of you.
Thank you. Thank you. Consider this way, just giving a 1 hour, maybe once a month, and we can take the turn and be present there and support Rhonda for the wonderful ministry. A lot of our kids, they are making steady progress, and I'm so proud of them and proud of their leadership going forward then. Let us move on to joys and concerns. Any joys and concerns to share? Yes, Thomas.
Only parents, especially mother, got both of them got coronavirus in one South Korea, and especially the mother is kind of a serious condition. So we are pretty much concerned about that. So please pray for Umi's parents, especially mother.
Thank you. Thank you. Our prayers will be with Umi's mother. Any other joys and concerns? Yes, Mike.
Yeah, the other day, my son was like, we're passing the torch. I go out and help with accidents when they're at the corner here. And the other day I came home, my son's hit just to help with an accident. And so it's a terrible corner. There's accidents once a week usually. So just tell the parishioners and your friends, just be careful at that corner.
Right here.
Yeah, right here at Japan and Broadway. Some years back, a pedestrian was killed on that corner. And there's been every range of fender bender to people getting taken away in ambulances.
Yeah. I make many left turns there, and whenever I do, I feel that tension. People are impatient. Yeah. Thank you. Any other joys and concerns? Yes.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jin. I returned back to this Northern Valley area since I graduated in 07. I went to Northern Valley, Denver, so my wife went to Old Japan. We're kind of coming home. So this is my first time here today. And thank you. And I look forward to meeting every one of you. Thank you.
Welcome. Any other joys and concerns? A good number of our church members are away for either family event or vacation and other businesses. Please keep them in your prayer. And I also remember some of our college students are now, I think, back on campus. So let's continue to support them and Sophie and Jackson and I know Tommy and some from our Korean worship. They are all back on campus. Let their academic year bear good fruit accordingly. I would like to invite all of you to join with me in prayer. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, we thank you that you are a God who shows up. Sometimes we don't notice that you are there, but like a loving parent watching over their little ones, you are near. Thank you for being there. But some of us, we want you to reveal yourself even more as pain and hurt are at the forefront of our mind. So we ask that you say hello and may we see that you are near because you love and care for us. We pray for those who may be feeling pain and physically or mentally. Rejuvenate their bodies and their soul and their mind. May they recognize your goodness in the little ones. And may their sorrow turn into joy, their pain into strength, and their mourning into dancing again. We also pray for those caring for these folks with compassionate listening and careful attention. We thank you for their care, and may you also give them avenues to rest and be hopeful. We pray for those who are looking for their next meal and do not know where it may come from. Holy God, take care of your children. and use your people to feed their siblings. May something nutritious and good be put in front of them. May they taste and see that you are good. We pray for the college student getting ready to return and already on campus, and for the student entering college for the first time, comfort them when they miss home and give them courage when they feel weak, and rejoice with them in the things that they find joy in. We pray for people who are looking for housing in our town and around as rent prices go up. Sometimes there is nothing more stressful than looking for a place to live. So give them avenues to rest and de-stress and to delight in goodness. Be with them as a journey in finding, not just a place to live, but a place they can call home. We also celebrate with you, God, for the good things that happen in our lives. We thank you for the good days and gatherings of friends and breaking bread together. We rejoice for the cool breeze at night. We thank you for the moments when we are reminded that we are loved and that through your grace, we are surely enough. We thank you for these things. May you bless our week through the good and bad, and may we see you in every aspect of our lives. We pray all this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. When people around us ask us, where is God? I can't see God. By sharing of what we have in time and treasure and our talents, we reach out to them and minister to them with God's help. This is time in response to God's goodness and God's graciousness. Let us bring our offerings and give to God. Like a river. We will sing first the three verses. now go forth from this place with a renewed inspiration to do the work of God. Seek good, not evil. Love goodness and establish God's peace and justice in the world. This is the greatest offering we can make. Letting justice roll down like waters and the righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Go in peace with the love for our neighbors. In the name of God, the Father, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.